Hi everybody. In the two previous videos, we found the wave functions and quantized energies associated with a particle in a one-dimensional box. In this video, I'd like to extend those concepts, both to higher dimensions and cases in which the walls of the box have finite potential energy rather than infinite. First, I'd like to remind us of where we left off. We found that the wave functions inside a one-dimensional box are oscillating. They're sine functions. And their energies are quantized and proportional to a quantum number n squared. We also saw that these wave functions have nodes, specific places where the object cannot be located. To start this video, we'll be moving on to a two-dimensional box. This picture shows the sort of environment we're talking about. Rather than just having a one-dimensional line segment, we now have a two-dimensional rectangle, where the box ranges from x equals 0 to x equals what we'll call L1, and from y equals 0 to y equals L2. Like the particle in a one-dimensional box, the potential energy equals 0 inside the box, and it equals infinity outside the box. Our wave functions and energies will be determined by the two-dimensional Schrodinger equation, shown here. The 2D Schrodinger equation is basically the same as the 1D Schrodinger equation, except the kinetic energy operator, rather than just having a second derivative with respect to x, now has a sum of second derivatives with respect to x and y. Based on what we've seen in the one-dimensional case, we can make some predictions of what the wave functions and energies will look like. First off, we know the wave functions have to be equal to zero outside the box, or else their energy would be infinite. We can expect that, like the one-dimensional case, the wave functions will be wave-like inside the box, in other words, sines and cosines. And because the postulates of quantum mechanics require that wave functions are continuous, we know that the different portions of the wave function have to meet each other at the edges of the box. In other words, the wave functions have to be equal to zero at the edges. So let's actually solve the Schrodinger equation. I realize that since most of us haven't taken a course in differential equations, it's hard to know where to begin. We'll begin by making an assumption about what form these wave functions will have. We assume that the wave functions will be a product of a function in x and a function in y. We'll call these functions capital X of the variable lowercase x and capital Y of the variable lowercase y. While it's not yet clear why we're doing this, it turns out that this will lead us to the correct answer, and that this is actually a strategy that we'll use often in quantum mechanics. Taking a more complicated multivariable problem and reducing it to simpler one-variable problems. If we make this assumption, we can then rewrite the Schrodinger equation, recognizing that the second derivative with respect to x only operates on the x part of the function, and the second derivative with respect to y only operates on the y part of the function. Next, we'll multiply both sides of the equation by negative 2m over h bar squared times capital X times capital Y, and end up with this. So let's take a look at where we are. We have one term that only includes x. This term can only be affected by changes in x. And we have a second term that can only be affected by changes in y. And this term in x plus this term in y is equal to a constant. So let's think about what that means. It means that the only way that this equation can be true for all x and all y is if both of these terms, the term in x and the term in y, are just constants to begin with. Knowing that each of these terms is equal to a constant, we can rewrite this one equation as two separate equations, an equation that says that the first term is equal to a constant, and an equation that says that the second term is equal to a constant. It really doesn't matter what we call the constants, but for convenience, we're going to write them as basically an x contribution to the energy and a y contribution to the energy. Next, we're just going to rewrite this equation in x a little bit by multiplying and dividing by certain terms, and we'll do the same thing with the equation in y. And then we'll take a look at where we are. We have two separate equations, one entirely in x and one entirely in y. And if you think back to the previous videos, you'll notice that each of these equations is completely equivalent to the particle in a one-dimensional box. We have one equation for a box in the x dimension, and one equation for a box in the y dimension. What this means is that our functions capital X will just be the one-dimensional particle in a box functions in X, and our functions capital Y will just be the one-dimensional particle in a box functions in Y. And remember, we made the assumption that the total wave functions are a product of capital X and capital Y. So the total wave functions are a product of the one-dimensional wave functions in each dimension. And also recall that EX and EY are essentially the X and Y components of the total energy. So the total energy is going to be a sum of the one-dimensional particle in a box energies in X and in Y. Let's summarize where this leaves us and look at some pictures. As we said, the wave functions for a particle in a two-dimensional box, psi of X and Y, are equal to a product of sine functions in the X dimension and in the Y dimension. And the energies are sums of the energies for a particle in a one-dimensional box. There are a few things I'd like to draw your attention to. First off, while there was only one quantum number n for the particle in a one-dimensional box, we now have two quantum numbers, n1 and n2. These quantum numbers specify the periodicity of the waves in the x dimension and the y dimension. Remember that in the one-dimensional case, there were always n-1 nodes. Now we have n1-1 nodes in the x dimension and n2-1 nodes in the y dimension. I would encourage you to look at the pictures of these wave functions on the left side of this slide and try to figure out what values of n1 and n2 they correspond to. For the particle in a one-dimensional box, each wave function corresponds to a different energy. That's no longer necessarily the case in a two-dimensional box. For example, if you imagine that we're in a square box where L1 equals L2, the situation in which there's one horizontal node would have the same energy as the situation in which there's one vertical node. So it's now possible to have degeneracy, wave functions that correspond to the same energy. While we won't cover it in this video, I'd encourage you to think about what the three-dimensional case would look like. See if you can figure out what mathematical form the three-dimensional wave functions would have, what they would look like, and what their energies would be. The other topic I'd like to cover in this video is quantum tunneling. To set the scene, let's think about an object that doesn't have enough energy to get over a hill. In classical mechanics, that object, of course, will not get over that hill. For example, if you roll a ball toward a hill and don't give it enough energy to get over the hill, it will roll back down. But one of the more mind-blowing things about quantum mechanics is that an object that doesn't have enough energy to get over a hill or through a barrier still might do it. And while that sounds like magic, it actually comes right out of the math. To see that, let's consider an object with some energy E that's going through an energy barrier with a potential energy V greater than E. As we've seen, the one-dimensional Schrodinger equation looks like this, and we've already explored it in a few contexts. One thing that we've already seen is that when the potential energy operator V is less than the energy of the object, E, the wave function oscillates. In other words, it's sines or cosines, like the inside of a one-dimensional box. As we've also seen, when the potential energy operator V is infinite, as it is outside the box, the wave function has to go to zero. The case that we haven't explored, and we will look at now, is the case where the potential energy operator V is greater than E, the energy of the particle, but still not infinite. Starting from the one-dimensional Schrodinger equation, let's go through the math. By adding and subtracting terms, we can put psi on one side of the equation and the second derivative on the other side. Then, if we multiply by 2m over h bar squared, we can say that a collection of constants, 2m times v minus e over h bar squared times psi, is equal to the second derivative of psi. Notice that because v is greater than e, the whole collection of constants in front of psi is positive. So the question I'd like you to think about is, what form do you think the wave function psi has? In other words, even if you haven't taken a course in differential equations, can you think of any types of functions whose second derivative is a positive constant times the function itself? I'll give you a few seconds to think about that. Hopefully you're thinking of exponential functions. something like e to a constant times x or e to a negative constant times x. In each of those cases, if you take the second derivative, you end up with a positive constant times the function itself. So for an object with energy capital E, the most general way of expressing the wave function is some constant c times e to the kappa x plus some other constant d times e to the negative kappa x, where kappa is equal to the square root of 2m times v minus e over h bar. A couple things to note about this. First of all, the only reason we're using kappa is that we generally use k for the particle in a box, and we don't want to get confused. Also, I would encourage you to actually take the second derivative of this wave function psi, and show that it is equal to the appropriate collection of constants times psi. The main thing to take away from this is that inside a barrier whose potential energy is larger than the energy of the object itself, the wave function decays exponentially, but it doesn't immediately go to zero. This is the idea behind quantum tunneling, and we'll see it in pictures in the next slide. At this point, we've seen that when a particle has an energy E greater than V, its wave function is oscillating, its sines and cosines. But when an object has an energy less than V, its wave function decays exponentially. So how do we put all of this together to think about an object moving through a barrier? We do that the same way we did for a particle in a box. We think about the boundary conditions, the fact that the wave function has to be continuous and smooth everywhere the potential energy operator changes. For a particle moving through a barrier, the wave function turns out to look something like this. Before it gets to the barrier, its wave function is oscillating with a certain amplitude. Once it hits the barrier, the wave function starts decaying exponentially and then ends up with a smaller amplitude by the time it makes it to the end of the barrier. And once it reaches the end of the barrier, it starts oscillating again, but because the amplitude has gotten smaller, you're less likely to find the object past the barrier. But the key takeaway is that there is some non-zero probability that the particle tunnels through the barrier. There's some fairly ugly math required to actually solve for the probability that a particle will tunnel through a barrier. But I do want to mention that in general, it's particles with very small masses through very thin barriers where tunneling is most likely to happen. This makes sense. We know that, for example, macroscopic objects don't travel through walls. So it's really only when we're talking about things as light as electrons and distances as small as the space between atoms where you're likely to see quantum tunneling. Finally, to tie this all together, I'd like to point out that we now have the tools to find wave functions and energies for any one-dimensional potential energy landscape. Consider, for example, the particle in a box with finite walls. Like the particle in a box, the potential energy operator inside the box is zero, but outside the box, it's not infinite. It has some finite value V0. Let's think for a minute about how we would find the wave functions and energies for this particle in a finite box. Like the particle in an infinite box, this really comes down to solving a system of equations for several unknowns. The unknowns are the particle energy and the coefficients of the general solutions to the Schrodinger equation. Those are the A's, B's, C's, and D's that we've seen as coefficients in front of the different terms in the wave function. And to find all of these unknowns, we have, first of all, a normalization condition for the wave function, and also several boundary conditions, equations that require that the wave function and its first derivative are continuous whenever the potential energy operator changes. Using all of these equations, it is in principle possible to find all of the unknowns and fully specify the wave functions and their energies. In practice, when there are a lot of steps in the potential energy operator, this is hard to do and probably requires a computer. But in principle, we now understand how it could be done. That's all for now. Next time, we'll move beyond the particle in a box and start to look at other important model systems in quantum mechanics.